Hello, welcome to another video from Far North Bushcraft and Survival. In this video, we're going to get into the Eskimo strap drill. I'll start off by performing the Eskimo strap drill friction fire, and then we'll go on into step by step, we'll construct one from the woods, and we'll get into the safety aspects of how to safely perform the Arctic strap drill. And we'll get into the many benefits of what sets the Arctic strap drill apart. And this is also known as the Eskimo strap drill or the Inuit strap drill. Okay, so stay with me as I set up the camera for doing the Eskimo strap drill. Okay, let's go get started on making us a set. Okay, the combination that I've found so far that works the best is a willow spindle and a poplar hearth board. Okay, we're in a stand of poplars here. Here's the little close-up of the bark and of the leaves. Okay. Now what we want is we're looking for some dead standing. Okay, here's a good one right here. But the trouble with this one is we have to get near the base in order for it to be thick enough to make a very good hearth board. And the base has just not too long ago, a month or two ago, has come out of the snow. There was snow enveloping it, and it's close to the ground. So that means moisture. So let's continue looking. Okay, we've got one over here. Right over there. Let's go see if that one will work. Yeah, this looks like a good one right here. We can get high enough up here to get a good hearth out of that. So stand by while I set up the camera. Okay, notice that this is barkless. That's what we want. We want to know that it's been dead for quite a while. And these poplars, when they are dead for quite a while, they lose their bark. The bark falls off of it. And so this should be ideal. Let's go ahead and cut it down. Okay, this will be the start of our hearth. Okay, now what we need to do is we need to split this in half. Need to look where the knots are and decide where we want to split it and go from there. Okay. All right, now we've got two nice neat halves. What we're gonna do is we're gonna make this, we're gonna step this. We're gonna notch it down and over. As you can see, this has got a step on it, right here. And that is a base for the ember to collect on. Okay, what I'm gonna do here now is I'm gonna analyze here which side I want my notch on, my step, okay? We've got a little bit of influence from a knot right here, but we can see that the knot is on this, not on, the knot is not on this half, it's on the other half. And also we have a little bit of influence right here from a knot, but it is also on the other half. I'm gonna take this side. So what we do is we go in and mark it how far back in we wanna cut it. That's gonna be how big our step is gonna be. Now keep in mind, as we go down, this is gonna get narrower, a narrower step. So I see now that this step would be just too narrow. Okay, so what I'm gonna do, so I'm gonna mark out the step, how long I want the step, and then we'll go up from there. Okay, so that's how we want it, about right there. Of course, this isn't exact science. It's just being rough, a rough estimate of where you need everything to be. Okay, now get started cutting it out. And for this, the best thing I've found is my knife, but yet still, it's very time consuming. I'm gonna start out by just shaving it down here. Down to the line. Both lines, top and the bottom down here. Okay. Now you're probably wondering how, you know, some of you are wondering, okay, just how far back in is he going? How deep is he making the notch? Okay, this is, I'm estimating the notch to be about a little over a half inch deep. Just a minute. I'll tell you exactly. Okay, it's right at about a half inch, right about a half inch, and about the same on going back in. All right, now, well, let's go down a little bit deeper here, first of all. Okay, now starts the tedious part. What I do is I run my knife in all the way across like that. And then turn it opposite. Now, the standard knife safety things apply here, of course. Shouldn't cut towards yourself in a way, such a way that you could slip. Now, there's probably an easier way of doing this whole operation, but I haven't got it figured out yet. All right, now we've got our initial line cut. We can run through it a couple of times here, make it a little bit deeper both ways. All right, now I'm not going to stick in here and pry it out and make sure I'm in the camera here. I'm not going to stick it in here and pry it out. The reason being is because I could split off this whole shelf, and I sure don't want to do that. So what I'm going to do is stick it in the side here and start prying. Yes, this is time consuming. But once you've got it done, then you've got a real nice handy hearth board that has many advantages over the other standard hearth board. Okay, that's basically it. Okay, now that I've got the hearth all carved out, it's time to do the spindle. So I found some willows, and I found a dead standing willow right here. I've been over checking it out already. We're going to use this willow. Okay, of course this is way too thick for our purposes, so, but it's nice and straight. It's almost completely straight. It won't have to take much to get it straight. So I'm going to start working on that. Okay, I've got it pretty close. And now when you get it to this stage, you want to be eyeballing it and whittle off any high spots. Try to get it as straight as possible. You need to have it as straight as possible, and the reason why is when you put this in your teeth, if you didn't bother to get it real straight, your head is just going to vibrate like crazy. It's going to rattle your teeth. So got to pay real special attention to getting off all the high spots, all the lumps and bumps that stick out, and the curves and everything. And you want the ends to be all lined up. Okay, now what I'm gonna do is I've narrowed this up for my socket or face piece, and this end I've kind of roughed out for the hearth. What we need to do is we need to spin this. Okay, we see it's real close here to the board, but it goes up higher here, so there's a ridge we need to trim off right there. And you just keep doing that until you can get everything real smooth. That'll tell you if your thing is curved at all, especially these tips, if they're carved off to one side, it'll help you to straighten the tips out. Okay, I've got it evened out pretty good. See, it rolls along there pretty good. Now, of course, you're not going to have, in a survival situation, you're not going to have a piece of plywood along. So you're just going to have to eyeball it. Just eyeball it as close as you can. And that'll actually get it pretty close. All right, now we've got this pretty much done. The next step is to get our socket, our mouthpiece, headpiece. All right, what I was looking for was birch. I was afraid I was gonna have to climb up into a birch tree and cut down a green limb. But we just found a treasure. Buck and I just found a treasure, my dog. While back we had a big snowstorm, wet. It wasn't too long ago, and it broke a lot of limbs out of the trees, and here's a birch limb that, you know, you can still see the green leaves started to come out on it. Broke this limb off. So we're gonna cut a piece out right about in there. All right, probably right in there. And we'll make a mouthpiece out of that. Okay, we've got a place carved out here for a bite area so we can bite. I switched to a smaller knife so that it'll be safer to operate, easier to operate through here for this process than the bigger knife. Okay, that's pretty good. Yeah, that's real good. And as you can see, I've started it on the divot as well. Started carving that divot. That divot needs to be quite deep. And the reason is you don't want that spindle to flip out. If that spindle flips out, it's possible that it could cause injury. But we'll go into that later on how to avoid that, how to do it safely. Okay, we're ready for the burn-in. Now we want this to, we want the hole to be, an eighth, the outside of the hole to be about an eighth of an inch in from the edge of the step here. But if it's a little more, a little less, that's okay. That's what we're working for. So we put the, I've got a little bit of a point on here. And I put that right where I want it, press it in, make an indent, and now I will increase that a little bit with the knife, just to give it a place to sit. Okay, I think we're probably ready to do the burn-in.
her.
All right, that ended up just about perfect. Now, we do a standard notch, just like we do on the standard bow and drill hearth. You want to end up about at the center, make a pie-shaped notch so it ends up, okay, do a pie-shaped notch to where the tip of it is about at the center of the hole. Okay, now let's, before we get started, let's go into a little bit of history. They call it the Eskimo strap drill, the Arctic strap drill, the Inuit strap drill, and the reason for that, it was used throughout the North Country by the Eskimos. Wherever the Eskimos were, this method was used. And they, okay, let's talk about the pieces. The hearth, they used the step hearth like this. This is an authentic design. They also used the two-hole method, where they would burn in a hole, then they would burn in another hole, and then they would begin to drill, and they would notch between the holes, those two holes. The ember would form in the empty hole. They would go back and forth, back and forth, back and forth, each time they would needed a fire, until the holes got too deep. And once that happened, then they would start a new hole and notch into the old hole, and the ember would form in the old hole. So on and so forth until the board was used up. They also had another method. It was just one single hole, and they were able to get an ember from that. My favorite method by far is the step hearth. Now the drill was varying lengths. That's a matter of preference. This drill is a little bit long. A drill a foot long works well for me. Now the mouthpiece. Traditionally, they made their mouthpieces out of bone or ivory. They made them fairly wide, and that was to protect the cheeks and the lips. They inlaid them typically with stone and put a divot in the stone, and that was so that their mouthpiece would last a long time, wouldn't wear out from the friction. This one, Charles gave to me, a friend of mine. And he put a brass insert into it, and it works excellent. He put a piece of leather on here to cushion the bite. Also, it gives a good grip with the teeth. So that discusses the parts. We're using 550 paracord. Traditionally, what they used was walrus hide or seal hide. That's why it's called a strap drill. Now this method, one of the advantages of the Eskimo strap drill is that it utilizes natural cordage very well, much better than the bow drill, since you don't have to tie cordage onto a bow. You just hang on to the cordage. I did a video earlier of where I used just a piece of willow bark, just straight off the tree, wrapped it around, and made an ember. wrapped around the drill and made an ember. You can also use spruce roots. Black spruce seems to work quite well. Now, let's get into the safety aspect of it. Okay, your mouthpiece, you want to make that divot pretty deep. And the reason for it is you don't want that drill to come out and threaten your face in any way. Okay, also, the drill, when you use it, you wrap it four times. I like to do it four times on the standard set here. And I'll show you why. I'm going to drill for just a little bit here, and then I'm going to back off and watch what happens to the drill. See that? It, as soon as it came out of the mouthpiece, it went over sideways quickly. There was no threat to the face, no threat to injury. And the reason for that is, okay, you've got the rope exiting down lower and exiting up higher. Quite a difference between the two. And they pull against each other. Let me do that one more time, demonstrate that one more time. There. So, be sure and wrap this. If you're gonna do it, be sure and wrap it multiple times. Also, you want it to come off of it on the side of the drill away from you. That's just one more aspect that keeps that drill from going towards your face if anything should happen to the mouthpiece. Okay. You also want to keep it down, keep your cord down low on the drill so that it's going to put the stress on the bottom of the drill rather than on the top of the drill so that you aren't taking any chance of breaking your mouthpiece. Or when this comes out, it's going to want to move away from your face again. All right, let's get started and see if we can do an ember. Oh. Another thing, another advantage to the Eskimo strap drill is that this is up off the ground. It's out of the snow. It's away from the wet ground. It's away from the wet leaves and the brush and whatnot. To protect that ember, give that chance, the ember a chance to form and to grow, mature. Get another alder leaf in here. There, looks like we got an ember. There. the work paid off. Hopefully you can see that smoke. Well, thanks for watching. And one more thing. I need to explain. Okay. When you're drilling, you want to pull towards your body so that if this, again, if the spindle is to come out of your mouthpiece, it's going to come towards your body. Don't pull away from your body like this. That'll keep it from coming towards your face. If you're pulled away from your body, it would go towards your face. You need to pull it towards your body slightly. So, thanks for watching, and we'll see you on the next video. You guys take care.